Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you feel able, please stand again for our Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are God only one. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
Our collect, our special prayer for the day. Almighty God, you've created the heavens and the earth and made us in your own image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works, and your likeness in all your children, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns supreme over all things, now and forever.
Amen.
Please do be seated. Irene's going to lead us in our first reading. The first reading is quite long. Sorry, Irene. But try to follow it through if you can, because that's what I'm going to be preaching on today, this first one from Genesis. Thank you.
A reading from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome, and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters, and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God he created them. Male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw that everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to the psalm is, for his mercy endures forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious.
For his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
For his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who alone does great wonders.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who by wisdom made the heavens.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who laid out the earth upon the waters.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who made the great lights.
For his mercy endures forever.
The sun to rule the day.
For his mercy endures forever.
The moon and the stars to govern the night.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who smote the firstborn of Egypt.
For his mercy endures forever.
And brought out Israel from among them.
For his mercy endures forever.
With a mighty hand and outstretched arm.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who divided the Red Sea in two.
For his mercy endures forever.
And made Israel to pass through the midst of it.
For his mercy endures forever.
But Pharaoh and his host he overthrew in the Red Sea.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who led his people through the wilderness.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who smote the great kings.
For his mercy endures forever.
And slew mighty kings.
For his mercy endures forever.
Sihon, king of the Ammonites.
For his mercy endures forever.
And Og, the king of Bashan.
For his mercy endures forever.
And gave away their land for a heritage.
For his mercy endures forever.
A heritage for Israel, his servant.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who remembered us when we were in trouble.
For his mercy endures forever.
And delivered us from our enemies.
For his mercy endures forever.
Who gives food to all creatures.
For his mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of heaven, for his mercy endures forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
The second reading is from the letter of Paul to the Romans. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subject to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labour pains until now, and not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks.
Before our gospel reading, we're going to sing our next hymn, which is number 152, For the Beauty of the Earth. Today I'm going to focus on the very first reading that Irene brought to us Genesis, because I so rarely get the opportunity to preach on it. And I love the beginning of this first book of the Bible. I think it's beautiful. It's full of hope. It's full of joy. It makes me think about some of the most beautiful places that I've been and seen, and some of the fantastic wildlife that I've been fortunate to see, some of the beautiful things around me. It can be as simple as the mist on the fields, the bluebells in the woods, or something altogether much more dramatic, just the beauty around us. It also makes me think of the beautiful people that I've met through life, and I don't mean the people who could be models or are models. I mean beautiful in what they do, in how they are, in how they welcome people, in the kindness that they show, or the generosity that they have. Maybe that reading made you think of some of the beautiful things or people or places that you've seen or experienced as well. Maybe it's making you think about them now. But it is a passage that's not very well understood and is often misused as well. Some see this as a literal account of how the world was made. Some places around the world refuse to allow any other understandings of creation, even discussion of different theories or different religions, to be discussed at all. They don't allow it to be taught. They don't encourage discovery or wonder. And I personally don't believe that this story of creation is meant to be taken as an historical record. It's not a historical book, but rather it's more like poetry, describing the wonder of creation and the hope that's at the centre of it as well. I think it's likely as well, though I could be wrong of course, like many biblical scholars now believe, that these passages of Genesis were first written down probably about 2,600 years ago, maybe a little bit earlier, could well have been written during a period in history when Jerusalem was destroyed and its people had been sent into exile in Babylon. And perhaps the way this is put together reflects an attempt of the people then to remind God's people of the hope that they have in God when they themselves were facing a very hopeless time, very desperate time. And we can learn a lot about God, about our attitudes to God, about God's relationship with us from the poetry of this short, didn't see me when we were listening to it perhaps, but this short section of Genesis. And we shouldn't write it off because either we think the world wasn't made in 7 literal days, or we think that it was and that's all it has to offer. There is far more to this than that. So this passage, and the chapter that follows it as well, so I recommend you go home later and read Genesis chapter 1 and Genesis chapter 2 into the start of chapter 3. And you'll see how there's another story of creation that follows this one as well. So these chapters have often been used through the centuries as a reason for imposing strict understandings and hierarchies of gender. You might have heard it used in this way, but never from me. I don't believe in a hierarchy of gender, and that's not what this passage is about. I think we do the creation story a huge disservice if we misuse it and abuse it in this way, because it has so much to offer. We shouldn't be limiting it. It's so beautiful and so full of hope. We're told partway through that passage on the sixth day that God created humankind in his image. And it says, male and female, he created them. It's described in this way not to limit God to our understandings of gender, but to show how God has no limits. Because remember, this was written at a time when men traditionally held all the power. It was written from a male perspective. And this is telling us that God is so beyond our understanding that whether we're male or not, we are created in God's image. All of us created in God's image. Now, the world's understanding of gender and of gender roles, especially, has broadened in the last few decades, particularly in the last 20 years or so. Although we still have a long way to go, there's still a lot of disagreement, hurt and debate. Some of you might have heard in the news this week, there was a little bit of a hoo-ha over a story that the Church of England was planning to introduce gender-neutral language in the Lord's Prayer. Did anyone come across that story in the news? It was there for sort of a day or so, and then was overtaken by lots of other news. It wasn't very clearly reported. It was seized upon as something really dramatic that the media could talk about, something that people could easily argue about. And I think it wasn't very well understood, so probably we did a bad job of explaining it. As I understand it, the idea was just to create more options in the way that the Lord's Prayer can be used and can be understood in different kinds of services, different options of the prayer that are authorised for us to use in the Church of England. And there's several options available already, even in our books. As you look later on, in our books today, there's two different options of the Lord's Prayer in here, one in traditional language and one in more modern language. Different churches have different versions. The Church of Scotland uses slightly different language. The Roman Catholic Church uses slightly different language. And there are other churches with different versions as well. So just different options to use in different situations. I think we're so used to referring to God as Father that it's good to be reminded that there are lots of other perfectly acceptable ways to refer to God. They don't all have to use male pronouns. It's what we're used to. We can continue to refer to God in this way, but we can remember there are other ways as well. Because we're reminded in that passage from Genesis that God is beyond our understanding of gender if we're all created in God's image. The Bible itself often uses some traditionally feminine language and some decidedly gender-neutral language to talk about God, such as describing God as a mother hen who shelters her chicks under her wings. And there's also some language that's more neutral, describing God as protector or redeemer. And there's some language as well that refers to God not even as a person, as we understand it, but different images like fire, or wind, or a still, small voice. Lots of different ways to refer to God. God is beyond our understanding of gender. All people, whether male, female, and those who describe their gender as neither of these, those whose gender is different from their gender of birth, are all created in God's image. Take a moment to reflect on what a beautiful statement that is. All of humankind created in God's image. All of us, however we present ourselves to the world, however welcome and accepted we feel or don't feel in the world, created in God's image. And God saw that it was good. In fact, God saw that it was very good. Now, the Church of England's taken this week some small steps towards some change that I believe better reflects this fundamental truth that we're all in God's image. After, it has to be said, a very long, very emotional, sometimes quite upsetting debate in General Synod. Although it's important to note, no doctrine is being changed at this time, but likely from July this year onwards, we'll have available to us, if you wish to use them, some prayers that can be used for blessing same-sex couples, as well as hopefully a gentler and a more welcoming guidance for clergy and others on matters of sexuality and on gender. Have to wait a few more months to see exactly what form this takes, but I personally welcome some progress, whilst acknowledging that there's a lot of people feeling very hurt at the moment for lots of reasons. And I strongly wish that progress was greater, but I welcome this progress. But this passage isn't just about gender, it is about people being in God's image. And you'll see there's no mention of skin colour in this passage. Nothing that some are better than others. Today, you may not be aware, is Racial Justice Sunday. And in a church that's overwhelmingly white, such as ours, I think it's easy for us to overlook this and makes it even more important that we don't. This is how understanding grows. Now, our own bishop, our Bishop of Kirkstall, Bishop Aaron, wrote to us all, to all the clergy and others, a few days ago about this. And he'd been delivering some training on racial justice to a group of people, and he said this. It was something of a reality check to discover that most, if not all, of those currently enrolled as diocesan interns and ministry experienced volunteers were unaware of the name of Stephen Lawrence. Some of us might be wondering too. Now, this year marks 30 years since Stephen's murder, and almost all of those, Bishop Aaron said, attending the training session on anti-racism that I delivered recently, hadn't been born in April 1992, when the aspiring architect was waiting at a bus stop in South London when he was violently attacked and stabbed to death for being black. Now, I think we know, all of us, the subsequent police investigation by the Metropolitan Police assumed that because Stephen was black, his death must have been his fault somehow, that he'd been involved in some kind of gang violence or something related to drugs or something else violent. And this was retribution, and it must have been his fault, and it showed how deep racism goes in our country. And there's still endemic racism throughout our country, including, we know, in the police, and in the Church of England as well. And we can be better than this, because we are, all of us, created in God's image. And God saw that it was very good. We are all created in God's image. Finally, it's impossible to preach today and not acknowledge the horrendous events in Turkey and in Syria this week after this awful earthquakes. And we know that the death toll keeps growing. It stands at some horrific number of over 28,000. At the moment, probably higher. It's likely to increase vastly in the coming days and weeks, and it's been awful watching this unfold. It's prompted a huge international rescue and relief effort, and there's also lots of questions being asked about the response from governments and from rebel forces as well, and why aid's not reaching where it should. And everyone has a lot of grief, a lot of questions. We thank God for the huge relief effort and the massive international cooperation that's enabled this, that people can work together in situations like this. And we pray, though, for the many victims, the many survivors facing a lot of horrors in lots of ways right now. And in Genesis, in the chapters that we've heard today and the chapters that follow it, it reminds us that we don't live in a utopia. We don't live in the Garden of Eden. We live in a broken world where there's many horrors as well as pockets of great beauty and great joy. And in the face of this, we keep our eyes fixed on Christ, on the hope we have in him. We remember that he calls people from every tribe, every nation, people of any background and any gender to work for the fulfillment his kingdom, as we live out his commandment to love our God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength, and to love our neighbours, whoever they might be, to love one another as we love ourselves. Amen. Please, could you turn to page 6 in your books now? And if you feel able, please stand with me as we declare our faith with the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sakes he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Please do be seated as Peter leads us in our prayers.
Creator God, we thank you for the wonders and the beauties of your created world. We thank you that we have read and learnt this morning of the ordered and wonderful way in which the heavens and the earth have been created. And we pray that this week, as we walk or drive around our world, that we may see the glories and see you, God, reflected in them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we remember that we are made in your image. Help us in the coming week to come up to that image, to live out in our lives the beauty, the love, the care that is in your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, this week we see that there is danger, there is violence in the world that you have created, and that suffering is part of that world. Lord, we do not understand everything about what happens in your universe, but we pray that we may see through the events of this week, and that we may see your care and your love being exercised in those countries and communities so savaged by the earthquake. We pray especially for governments at this time, that they may review their priorities and see the urgent need to help others and put that above their selfish local concerns. We pray for all aid agencies as they struggle to get help to the places where it is most needed, against the barriers of geography and politics. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. At this time we pray especially for all those who are suffering loss, bereavement, and the dreadful uncertainty of not knowing what has happened to their loved ones. Be with them, hold them up and help them, and pray that they may be helped by the aid that is coming. We pray especially for the Disasters Emergency Committee in this country, bringing together the activities of all the national charities to give focused help where it is needed. And may our hearts be moved to see that we can help by in this way, by giving of the riches that we have to help those in desperate need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we pray for our country. We pray for our king and our government, that they may rule with wisdom and find ways through the strife and difficulty that is around in much of our society at present. We pray especially for all those who are working in the National Health Service, that a just solution may be found that will enable them to return fully to work. We pray for all those who are in need of health care in our own community. We pray for doctors in our health centre, for nurses in our hospitals, for ambulance drivers who live in our community, that they may be giving help where it is needed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for those in our own community who have lost loved ones. And we pray especially for the family of Margaret Blakely, due to be buried later this month. And we pray also for all those who are sick and who have asked for our prayers, for Anne, Christine, Roland, Catherine, Neil, Patricia, Malcolm, Janet, Bina, Betty, Jenny, Sylvia, Ruth, Amelia, and Diane. Hold them up and bring them healing and help in their suffering. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, I accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yeah.
Gracious God, you spread a table before us. Nourish your people with the word of life and the bread of heaven. Amen. We'll use the words of the Eucharistic prayer that just follows on page 8. The Lord be with you.
And the Lord be with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to citizen who meet with you.
In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him, and he in us.
He opened his heart to love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice of sin.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread, gave me thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we can do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave me thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our Lord.
And with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you which has raised so far, I think it's about £125-130, which is really good. We'll have a final total next week. Thank you very much, everyone. Now, see if I can read the right line. Like last week. Soon it will be Ash Wednesday. So Pancake Day comes first, Shrove Tuesday, and then Ash Wednesday is the 22nd of February. So we have a special service on Ash Wednesday. In the evening here in St Oswald's, it's at 7:30 in the evening. No, I don't come in the morning, it's in the evening. It will be a communion service and what we call ashing. Some of you are familiar with this, some of you might not be, where we use some ash just to make a little cross on our heads as a symbol of penitence on a special day. So if you wish to come along, you're very welcome. There's a service during the day as well over in Muddlesford. It's at 9:30, so a slightly earlier start, so that they don't combine with the Bollywood dance class that's in there after the Ash Wednesday service. Maybe we should have combined them, I don't know. But that's at 9:30 on Ash Wednesday in Woodlesford Parish Hall, if you'd like one during the day. We're going to be starting a course that's going to run through Lent, and it'll finish off the last 3 weeks after Easter as well, after a break. And this is called the Bible Course. It's a really, really interesting course. It talks about what the Bible is, how it was put together, how it was written at different times, about the different themes through the Bible, about the Old Testament, the New Testament, how we fit it together, how we make sense of it, and how we use it in our lives as well. How do we even read the Bible? How do you find something in the Bible? It's a really fantastic course. It's going to run as our Lent course, but beyond as well, because it's 8 weeks in total. Course sounds really formal, but it's just a series of meetings for 8 weeks talking about these different topics, with some video clips to help us, and lots of discussion, and some refreshments as well. So that's going to start from the 1st of March and run every week through March on Wednesday nights at 7:30. Here in church, so 7:30 on Wednesday nights in March, here in church. We'll have a sign-up sheet ready for next week if people wish to say that they'll come along to the first session, or if you can't make the first but you want to come to another one, just so that we've got a vague idea of how many are coming and what sort of refreshments to get as well. I can't commend it to you enough. It's a really good course. It's great whether you've been coming to church for 70 years or if you're new to church. It's a great way of looking at the Bible in a new way, and a good chance to meet other people as well and learn about different experiences of the Bible as well. And also over in Woodlesford, again, we're offering something during the day as opposed to an evening course. And starting on the 2nd of March, Thursdays at 12:30, they'll be running a Lent group that comes with lunch as well. So if you want to come and have soup and bread and tea and coffee, whilst also learning about this time a film called The King's Speech, and how we use our own voices. And obviously there's some Bible passages as well. We're not going to watch a film, but it's going to be really quite interactive and good fun. And you're welcome to come along to that as well. Right.
Sarah.
What else should I say? Anne, yes.
Messy Church next week.
Oh yes, Messy Church is next week, which is the 19th, is that right?
Yeah.
Sunday the 19th at 3:30 in our church hall, Messy Church. You're welcome, just come and try it if you've not been before. You're welcome to come and have a go as a helper as well, if that's something you're interested in.
Do you want to say anything about the healing group, Diana? Do you want to?
Hang on. Just pass it. Yeah, I just, there's something on the notice sheet about the healing stroke prayer group. This is just to sort of relook at what we used to do, because I don't know what we used to do as a prayer group and a healing group. So I've arranged this meeting, I'm aware it's on in the day, but it's just to get everybody together who's involved in it in the past, just to sort of find out what you did and maybe what not to do. But anybody who's interested in that, please come to the meeting. If you can't make the meeting but you're interested in it, then just let me know and I can add you into the discussions, and then hopefully we can see where God wants us to use that ministry. Here.
When is it?
Sorry, that meeting is
28th,
thank you. February the 28th, after tea and coffee after the communion service in St. Margaret's Hall. Thank you, Mika.
Anything else to share? Anything I've forgotten? It's quite common. ever do. Okay, let's sing our final hymn, number 327, Immortal, Invisible. 327. Spirit be with you and remain with you this day.